When it comes to behavioral interviews, one of the biggest blockers people can have is to kind of imagine that they have to memorize or prepare answers to highly specific questions well ahead of the game. So they'll tend to think like, oh, I need to have an answer ready for, like tell me about the toughest problem that you faced in your last job, or tell me about this, or tell me about that. And so this can like feel very daunting. And as a result, a lot of people have analysis paralysis. They sort of freeze up and then they don't do any preparation, which is actually the worst of all possible worlds. So what I'm hoping to convey today is that there's actually a middle ground. There's a way to establish principles that you can use to help you think about your answer right after you've been asked a question. So foundational, kind of compressible lessons learned that you can apply across the board to basically all behavioral interview questions. So what I'm hoping to do today is both to convey what those lessons are and to show how they can apply to different kinds of behavioral interview questions. So right out the gate, I just want to start with the purpose of your performance in a behavioral interview, what you want to show, the thing that you had better be able to demonstrate during these conversations. So the first one is you want to show introspection. Okay, you want to show the ability to like look inside and figure out how you work, because that will help you relate to other people. Like one of the primary purposes of a behavioral interview is essentially to show that you're going to be fun to work with, a reasonable person who's not going to fly off the handle if you encounter a disagreement or if you get into some kind of conflict with somebody in the workplace, which is why all the behavioral interview questions are so conflict focused. Right? They really want to understand, like, are you a person who's capable of admitting fault? So introspection is really nice. If you think about the kind of person that you would really prefer not to work with, somebody who's incapable of thinking about their own actions, their own sort of internal workings, is probably pretty high up on the list, right? Because this is somebody to whom the external world is the locus of control. So they have to control the external world because they assume there's nothing I can do about my internal process. I'm already perfect. So that's not good. You really want to show introspection, ability to recognize sort of places where you can be improving your behavior. The second is that you can actually show that you can actually act on introspection. So a lot of people will say stuff like, "I'm really bad at X," or "I'm not so great at Y," or whatever. But then they stop there, and that is sort of a that's a very pregnant place to stop. If you've identified an issue that you have, that's great. It's definitely better than not identifying it. But there's a missing step. You have to, like, ideally, you want to turn the answer into an A plus answer by talking about what you have changed in your life to address that lacuna, that sort of that problem that you've identified. Sorry about the flipping back and forth here, folks. People are just joining. So anyway, show introspection, show that you can act on introspection. And the last piece here is show empathy. So a really common motif that happens when you ask somebody a question like, hey, tell me about the last time that you had a workplace conflict, for example, is people will, in spite of themselves, they'll kind of get into accusatory mode. So they'll start describing like, oh, I had a boss who did this really unreasonable thing, and she put me in this position, and there was like, there's nothing I could do, and it all blew up, and it was all her fault. So when you're faced with a question about, workplace conflict, things like that, and you fail to show this kind of empathy, in other words, you fail to look at the situation from the other person's perspective, that's a real red flag, because the people interviewing you are always going to wonder to themselves, like, man, I wonder if I'm going to be, if you're going to be talking to the next employer, telling stories about them or other coworkers. So this is actually really important. Even in cases where you're telling a story where your manager or whoever you're working with actually was unreasonable, and that will happen. We've all worked with terrible bosses and things like that. Even in those cases, though, you need to default to showing empathy. That can even mean like making them seem more reasonable than they were in the moment, but it certainly means trying to make them seem as reasonable as possible. Okay, so maybe I'll just pause there, just check in. Hopefully that makes sense. Does anybody have any questions about that sort of initial setting? Okay, cool. I just want to give a little bit more of a concrete picture of what I mean for each. So when it comes to show introspection, like the way I like to think about this is identify your role in creating the problem. So if you're describing like a workplace conflict or a time where you and your supervisor disagreed or a time where you had difficulties in the context of a group project, like all of these scenarios that you might be asked to discuss are going to presumably involve a problem and how you navigated it, it's really important to be able to identify the things that you did wrong. A lot of people shy away from this. They kind of think like this interview is somehow a test of like whether or not you're a perfect person. And that's very much not what a behavioral interview is, right? So we all are flawed people. We suck in many, many different ways. Some of us have short fuses. Some of us are too agreeable and don't stick up for ourselves when we have ideas that deserve to be shared. And then the company loses out in that case too. And so there are all kinds of different reasons why, we might have played a role in creating like a workplace problem or just a marginal inefficiency. It's really, really worth kind of thinking about when you're thinking about the stories you'll be telling in these interviews. Identify like what you did suboptimally. It doesn't have to be like an awful thing that you did, but just kind of something that you can mention that again shows that introspection. It shows that, I have a lens on myself, or at least I'm capable of deploying a lens on myself and my actions in the context of these interviews. Or sorry, these events, these conflicts. Show that you can act on introspection. This really is like identify the lesson. So one of my favorite things to do anytime I drill behavioral interviews with my mentees is I will always force them to tell me what was the lesson. What was the actionable piece of information that you gained from this event? How did it change your life? I mean, presumably, if you're flagging a problem, if you're flagging an issue that arose and a scenario where you behaved suboptimally, where you had some kind of role in creating a problem, then, I mean, that very much implies that there's some kind of behavioral shift that you should actually carry through. So think about what that might be. It can be something very simple, and I'll give some examples in a second. But you really want that to put you over the top, to give you that sort of A plus answer. It's not always good enough just to say like, yeah, this bad thing happened, and in hindsight, I wish I had been clearer with my supervisor about X. Like, that's good. It's good that you've identified your role in creating the problem, but like, what habits have you picked up? What have you changed about the way you communicate with your team members, the way you think about that communication even, that now means that this is less likely to happen in the future? If you're the kind of person who actually does that, like my own personal concern about getting into a shouting match with you about, I don't know, some feature that we're going to build or some user we're going to target, it decreases a lot. I feel a lot more comfortable talking to people who are capable of kind of iteratively improving on their performance during tough times and tough conversations. Showing empathy. So this one is, I'm going to repeat this. This is a really tricky one. Like, you have to show that you're able to see the world through the perspective of the people you are disagreeing with. When you're telling a story about, for example, suppose worst case scenario, your boss tells you, hey, so and so, you had a terrible week. Come right into like the middle of the office, and I'm gonna chew you out in front of like 20 other colleagues and coworkers, right? This is like a wildly inappropriate thing for a boss to do. That's totally unacceptable. You still should try to show some kind of empathy. Ask yourself some basic questions like, well, I wonder if they were having a bad day, because that really is a weird sort of thing to do. So you can tell your interviewer, for example, like, look, my boss had me come in front of like everybody, and he read me the riot act, to sort of listed all my faults and this and that. Now, it was an awful experience, and I suspect really he did it because he was under a lot of stress and this and that. You want to tell their side of the story, even if you have to push it to be extra empathetic, simply because you want to show you're capable of that empathy, right? So like, that's the test here. The real test isn't to see like, are you a perfect person? The real test is to see, in the context of this conversation, in retrospect, are you able to identify with other people? And like, weirdly enough, the more extreme the in some cases, like the abuse you put up with, the more impressive it can be to, in a very measured and thoughtful way, not apologizing for the behavior, but sort of trying to explain it in your own mind, the more compelling that can be. because that implies that you're able to deal with difficult people, and difficult people will pop up. I mean, that's just sort of a fact of life. Okay, so any questions about this stuff again? Again, it's just the kind of groundwork laying, but... Okay, cool.
I have another question. So you mentioned that showing introspection and being able to kind of like reflect on your own weaknesses in a situation. What type of weaknesses are we to find? Like, we're supposed to say, fine, like, I had this weakness based on this situation, but here's what I've done to overcome that weakness, right? But not to mention weaknesses or like some or type of weaknesses that you should totally avoid mentioning in interviews.
Okay, this is an excellent question. And it speaks to, this is like really tough for people who, especially when you're doing behavioral interviews for the first time. So I'll just start with recommending a bit of a mindset shift. And that is, we often come into interviews, whether they're behavioral or technical, thinking of them as an adversarial process. And this isn't necessarily the best lens. I mean, we're trained to do this because school, like, you know, you're given like a box and it's like the teacher doesn't believe that you actually did the homework and they want to test to see if you did. So they give you a box and you got to put your answer in the box and it's got to be, you know, perfect and all that. In the context of an interview, especially a behavioral interview, it's much more exploratory and much more collaborative. People often have that school-like sort of response where they get defensive and they don't want to dive into like weaknesses. They get a little overprotective of their weaknesses. So the first thing I'll say is I recommend erring on the side of sharing more rather than less. There is a limit. When you're talking about your weaknesses, you definitely want to talk about weaknesses that you've thought of enough to address. And this is really show that you can act on introspection. So like, don't pick a weakness where you're like, well, for example, don't go saying like, yeah, I have a massive drinking problem and I do not have that shit under control. Like that would be a bad idea, right? So there's some obvious extremes at that end, but there are things along the continuum. I mean, you want to be honest, and to the extent that you've thought of weakness, if you actually have that weakness in mind, and if you haven't acted on it, you probably should anyway, right? So like, if you're at that point where you have a weakness that you're embarrassed enough to discuss because you don't have even a plan to address it, then that might actually mean that you should consider taking a step back and actually saying, well, should I do a little bit of self-work here and try to address that weakness? I know this is pretty general, partly because behavioral interviews are quite vague, but hopefully that gives a bit of a sense. Do you have any follow-up questions on that, Ali?
No, I think that makes sense.
Okay. And again, hopefully it'll become a bit clearer as we talk about examples in the next slide or two. Cool. So just one last thing I want to highlight. This thing, identifying the lesson, the reason this is like a really almost magical thing to do is it immediately puts you in a completely different bucket from everybody else. So the vast majority of people, when they're asked to identify their role in creating a problem implicitly, you know, when they're asked a question like, tell me about a time you had a workplace conflict or whatever it is, the vast majority of people will take that question literally. They will kind of describe what happened, and then they'll fold their arms and be like, all right, I'm done, right? I told you about a time I had a workplace conflict. But you're being asked to chew the fat and elaborate on your reasoning. That's the introspection part. The identification of the lesson, the moment you talk about like, so this was my role in it, and therefore I did this, that immediately puts you in a completely different bucket. It puts you in the action-oriented bucket. The kind of person who doesn't just see a problem and let it slide, the kind of person who sees a problem, even if it's within themselves, and goes, oh, damn, I gotta do something about it, right? So this, like, weirdly enough, it doesn't seem like on the surface this would be a big deal, even like in a maybe technical context, but it actually does cross over quite a bit. If you're the kind of person who goes, oh, I noticed that, you know, I have a tendency not to check in with people about my work as often as I should. And then you, for example, like I do, you set a timer to remind you at certain key moments that, hey, now's a good time to check in with people. Like, that's a really good sign that you're the kind of person who identifies solutions to problems as well as problems themselves. And that most likely, especially if you have like a good strategy to suggest, you might actually end up giving your interviewer a strategy that they'll find useful themselves. And that in and of itself is going to be a good bonding moment. So I guess all this is to say, really seek to not only answer the question literally, but really elaborate on it and try to establish the kind of person you are through your answer and through the way that you elaborate on the answer. What you consider to be important has got to be how introspective you are and how you act on that introspection. And of course, the empathy bit. I mean, the empathy bit is almost like damage control, because like you will get situations where people wanted to like just rip up, like, you know, I've had bad former bosses. I think everybody here has. You know, you just want to rip into them, tell your side of the story, and you know, fuck you, and that's it. But this is not the time, right? Doing that during a behavioral interview, it makes you come across as vindictive. It makes you come across as unempathetic. And everybody always thinks they're right. So, you know, you feeling super right does not mean that you are actually right. And showing empathy means that you understand that implicitly. You're able to see the world from someone else's perspective. So, bias towards action, that's really what's magical about that second piece, but you do want all three as much as you can. Again, I'll repeat these one more time, or maybe read these off one more time before we get into examples. But you want to show introspection, show you can act on it, and show that you have empathy. And anyway, that's the main goal. Okay. The like maybe the most stereotyped, generalized behavioral interview question is this: what are your greatest strengths and weaknesses? I actually think that there's a good reason for that, and that is that this question is probably the most useful question to be able to answer really, really well. And to Ali's question, actually, this is going to force us to discuss, you know, what kinds of, you know, what does a strength sound like? What does a weakness sound like that it's okay to discuss in this context? And how should you frame them? And all these questions matter a lot. So the first thing I want to do whenever you're facing a question like this is to invite you to think about your personality and to think about specific personality traits. Okay, things that are neither good nor bad, but a little bit of both and neither. One of the axes of personality that's really great to work with for questions like this is introversion, extroversion, right? There are strengths associated with introversion, there are weaknesses associated with extroversion, and there are strengths associated with the other one, whichever one I didn't say, and there are weaknesses associated with that one too. So at the end of the day, by identifying personality traits, it kind of allows you to depersonalize the conversation, so you'll feel a little bit more comfortable discussing, especially your weaknesses. I think that's the one people usually get really nervous about. And you can find there are sort of psychology personality inventories that have been done. Basically, you can think of this as something like PCA, roughly speaking, where people give test takers giant questionnaires, and then they look at like what are the five principal components of personality. And it turns out that their introversion, extroversion is one. There are a whole bunch of others like conscientiousness and one called neuroticism, basically just sort of kind of attention to detail at a certain point. Anyway, there are a whole bunch of different personality traits that you can hook onto when you answer this question. And some of them you'll see more in yourself than others, but I recommend checking these out. I'll just write this here so you can maybe Google them. So these are called like the big five personality traits. And somebody just dropped a message in the chat. Oh yeah, okay, great. I'm glad, Jeremy. Yeah, so I think for data scientists, it's actually worth knowing this, because at least my attitude with respect to the big five was when I first heard about it, like I'm not gonna lie, I thought it was BS. I thought, you know, like some psychologist had just like, I don't know, decided introversion, extroversion, like conscientiousness and whatever else. And it turns out it's actually like, it's a factor analysis, which in a weird way is kind of like inverse PCA, but it's all basically the same idea. Yeah, linear algebra gets you there. So this is actually like, especially if you're a data scientist, you can appreciate that this is like a real thing. So definitely check that out, and then, you know, think about where you fall along all five of these axes. And anyway, as you'll see, that'll inform how you answer questions like this one. So I'm going to give you an example answer that I'm going to try to use to hit at actually mostly the first two of these the first two of these things. Keep in mind, like, you don't have to show all three of these for every question, but you definitely want to show all three of them during the entire interview, right? You're going to have a couple behavioral questions whenever you can. If you see an opportunity to show some empathy, to see the world from somebody else's perspective, yeah, drop that in there, right? But, you know, if you can only reasonably squeeze in the first two or whatever else in any given question, that is totally fine as well. So, what are your greatest strengths and weaknesses? I can actually tell you, as I'm an introvert, so that's where I fall on that spectrum. And that means I get energy from alone time, so from being on my own. Nothing is more fatiguing to me than actually being on a call like this with a whole bunch of human beings, or even, you know, work calls and stuff like that. I mean, with people that I know well, it's less energy intensive, but anyway. So it costs me a lot of energy to interact with people. And that means I can focus down. So one advantage of that, and the strength I get from my introversion, is I don't need that interaction. So I'm not a person who needs to stand up from my desk and, like, go over to Holly in accounting or Joe in marketing or whatever and start up a conversation to re-energize myself. I'm able to focus for really long periods of time. But because I'm focusing down for really long periods of time, and because it costs me energy to rope in other people, I tend not to get other people involved in looking my work over as often as I should. And that's the weakness. These all naturally come from my kind of baseline personality. Everybody knows introverts, everybody knows extroverts, so immediately kind of relate to it. You know, I'm often the person making up excuses for why I'm not going to go to the party, you know, this evening or whatever, because it costs me energy. And then that comes at social cost too. So I have to make an effort to overcome that. Broadly though, the strategy that I use, I mentioned it earlier, but I actually set a timer. So as I'm working, every hour I have a timer go off just as a, like, reminder for myself to go, is what I'm working on right now really the best thing I could be working on? And should I be soliciting input from other people? And I force myself to open Slack when that happens. And, you know, if there's, at that point, if there's something that I do feel like, you know what, I think I will put in that marginal effort, it just makes it a lot easier to engage in that behavior. So there's my strategy, right? I have the initial kind of bit of introspection where I'm talking about, like, hey, like, this is my personality, and that's the role that it plays in creating, well, in this case, the strength and the weakness. And then here's the lesson. Here's the strategy that I use to mitigate the problem that arises due to that personality trait. And I think somebody entered something in the chat here. yeah, thanks, Jeremie. Appreciate it. Yeah, so anyway, so that's a high-level picture. I think this sort of thing can take a while to polish. And this is why I really recommend, like, check out the Big Five. Do a free personality inventory. I will drop one in Slack so you can check them out. There are a whole bunch of, like, free but also, like, totally legit tests that you can take just to kind of get a vague sense of, like, where you fall on these spectra. And then start constructing answers or around these things. Just to give one quick example, if it wasn't introversion, extroversion, right, we could have talked about conscientiousness, which is, like, attention to detail. And, you know, if you're highly, highly conscientious, like, that's awesome. You're probably really, really good at doing things like tracking down bugs in code, making sure you're not missing any features that you should include in your problem statement or whatever. But at the same time, that comes with a, you know, can't see the forest for the trees type problem. So you might want to work on techniques that pull you out of detail and into a more strategic world. So anyway, you can see how each of these personality dimensions really do lend themselves to different strengths and weaknesses. And the last thing I'll mention is, you know, when I come out and say I'm an introvert, if that's, like, the very first sentence that I say when I'm being interviewed, that has a humanizing effect that's pretty dramatic and immediate, right? The interviewers know a lot of introverts, and it's 50-50. They might be one themselves. And if they are, then immediately, like, you've connected with them, right? And if they're not, you have the ability to help them understand their coworkers. And surely they're working with introverted coworkers, especially in data science and kind of software adjacent fields. So with that out of the way, what I want to do is I'm going to embarrass some of you by asking you to answer this question. You're going to do your best. It's, you know, it's not going to be good, and that is all good, or it may be amazing, but don't expect it to be great. I just want to put you guys in that position, have you wrestle with the question a little bit in an environment that seems a little bit high pressure. You got other people listening here. And as you answer, I'm going to pop this up here. like actually here, you know, try to hit that, especially those first two for this question, like show introspection, show that you've thought about yourself. So lead with a personality trait. And then ideally, if you can think of a strategy that you could implement to address that issue, then so much the better. So just to put somebody in the hot seat here, let's say Austin, what are your greatest strengths and weaknesses?
This is good because I actually have an interview tomorrow, so kind of talk over this. So as you've been talking, I guess it's kind of in the back of my mind. I would say, well, strengths first. When you were talking about not being able to see the forest for the trees, I think I can. I think that is not a problem I have. I think I actually tend to want to know about the whole forest before I start work on anything. Which I guess I could turn that into a strength or a weakness. But I see that as a strength in a lot of ways. Basically, I think that being able to integrate my knowledge of the whole project into any individual aspect of it kind of gives me the ability to understand what needs to happen next, what the best decision at any given point is, knowing the impacts it could have across the rest of it. So I would say that's a strength. Weakness, I would say, would be more so, I think I like to gather all data before making any decision. I want to know everything I possibly can before making a decision that can lead to behavior that ends up looking a whole lot like procrastination, and probably is. So I would say that one way that I have learned that about myself and one way that I have learned to deal with that is that deadlines kind of make the whole difference there. If I have different steps that I'm looking at, then I know that I need to get to this point by this given time, then I only have that much time to gather data, figure out what the best way of doing something is. So within that time frame, it gives me basically the ability to kind of pace myself out and get to that point when I need to. And I would say also communicating those deadlines to people involved in the project so that I am kind of accountable to that.
Okay, that's a beautiful answer. I think one of the really, one marginally useful thing that maybe you might consider doing as well is to see if you can map those two, the strength and the weakness, to like a common theme. It seems like you're sort of a, you're almost like a data collector. You're a big data collector. So you develop that strategic picture. So you zoom out, you're like, okay, I understand how everything fits together. And then you zoom in and you understand how everything fits together. And then you begin to execute. And my guess is when you execute, you're going to really surprise people with how fast you can move. Because you seem to go from zero to all of a sudden everything's mapped out. So that, to me, that's a really cool, and your strategy, I mean, it makes perfect sense.
Very cool. Yeah, appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. All right. Great way to kick us off. So I'll pick on somebody else here.
I have a quick question actually before we move on, Jeremie. So when answering this kind of question, how crucial is it to provide an actual scenario where your strength or your weakness played out versus just being like, this is a strength and this is a weakness and this is generally how I solve them?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think the short answer is generally it's not critical, but concrete examples tend to go a bit further than abstract examples or just abstractions, I guess. It's helpful because it also avoids miscommunication. Like sometimes people will, you know, if you hear, for example, Austin's answer, one way he could have dealt with it abstractly is he could have said something like, you know, I'm a really good strategic thinker. He could have left things basically at, I'm a really good strategic thinker. And then you'd be like, okay, what does that mean? So getting a little bit further into the concreteness territory by saying, if I'm faced with a new problem, I will do this and that, and then I won't do this. Like, that's a little bit more helpful. I think giving an example would actually be even better. I mean, you can hardly lose by doing so. It's just that sometimes they won't come to mind. I think that's the main blocker. And I think you want to be psychologically ready to not have an example there. It's okay. Like, you know, you're not going to lose that much, but it is a nice cherry on top, I'd say. Does that make sense?
Totally makes sense. Thank you.
Cool. And I think this is one key thing too, is like really make sure that you don't, after I've finished giving you guys like a list of three things that you must include, just don't judge yourself too much if you miss out on the odd thing. You know, interviews are a long game. You're going to have more interviews. You're going to have more questions in a given interview. So if you kind of miss the mark on one, it's okay. Like, you know, you'll catch the ball next time. Just make sure that you try to be mindful about how you might have fumbled it, right? So you can iterate and improve for next time. Great question, Jeremie, and great answer, Austin. All right, so I'm gonna pick on Sina. What are your greatest strengths and weaknesses?
I can say I for my strength, I think my biggest, like, most useful, most important trait is that I'm very flexible in terms of both communicating with people and also in the work that I'm doing. Like, I always try to give myself feedback in terms of what I'm doing, and I'm very flexible in terms of, like, choosing other directions that I think it would be better, or also other teammates or, like, managers would think that would work best. So I'm very flexible in that term as well. And I'm also very considerate of other people's opinions as well, which sometimes can be my weakness as well. So through my work, I realized that sometimes instead of pointing out some of the, conflicts or disagreements, I just try to be considerate around that, and these will, like, be added together, and it will become a, like, much larger conflict, which is very hard to solve. So what I did was that daily communication about very small steps in the work, it worked for me very well. So you can just talk for 30 seconds about very small issue to a project with your manager, with your supervisor, in a day and solve it, and then go on with your project. And then if I don't do that, it will, like, at long term, it would cause a huge problem. So far it worked for me.
Great. Okay, so first thing I want to point out too is that Sina, so you just highlighted one of the personality traits I was struggling to remember, which is agreeableness. So you're absolutely right. So the way that would be nutshelled is, like, I have a very agreeable personality. I tend to, you know, shy away from conflict. And as a result, I have to make an effort consciously to ask myself if I'm avoiding conflict to avoid conflict, or if I'm avoiding conflict for legit reasons. I think that's a great answer. I would definitely, as you do those personality tests, you know, take a look at that agreeableness score and see if there are strategies even for, like, you know, how can agreeable people navigate conflict? I suspect that there are going to be a lot of, you know, great blog posts and things like that. Excellent answer. That's really good. So one thing, especially with that, and at the beginning, I was having a little bit of trouble kind of pinning down exactly what you meant. It became super clear as the answer went on. So I think this will just come through practice. I mean, you did a great job, especially given that you're in front of all these people. It might be worth thinking about a concrete example, maybe, especially in your use case. But I really like the answer. That was great.
Thank you.
Awesome. So I got to say, I'm surprised by how well you guys did. I don't know that I would have done nearly as well in your shoes. So great. I want to flip the question here. And as we look at these other questions, one strategy I want to keep bringing back is going to be, you know, think about how you tackled the answer to this question. So you started by thinking about a personality trait, right? Something about you, and then you turned it into eventually a solution, right? So that can be a pretty helpful way to think about almost any question. Right, describe a time when you had to deal with a difficult coworker. So certainly you're going to have to describe a scenario here. The question explicitly asks for something concrete. But as you're navigating this example, try to keep in mind, like, how did your personality play into this? Right? Of course, there's the catchword here is difficult, right? And that's almost baiting you. It's almost asking you to say, like, yeah, there was this one guy called Steve and he was an absolute dick and he did this and that. Like, Like, don't say that. You know, they're saying difficult coworker, but that's almost an invitation for you to take a more diplomatic tone and say, well, you know, I had this coworker and, you know, they were difficult, but you can kind of understand why, blah, blah, blah. And then you can talk about as well, like, and I think my personality played into this too. You know, if I were Sina, for example, let's say you had a workplace conflict, I might say something like, in retrospect, I think my agreeableness might have delayed a conflict and made it worse over time or something like that. So, you know, thinking about ways to infuse a little bit of responsibility in a certain way into the scenario, describe at least the role that you played in it, because probably no matter how innocent you might have been, there are probably some ways in which your behavior was imperfect. So you could probably think about ways to improve it. By the way, I do really want to quickly mention, don't go so far as to like blame yourself for getting yelled at, right? That's not what this is about. It's just about thinking strategically, purely strategically. Could I have played this better? Could I have played this in a way that was better for the company, better for myself, better for my relationships? So anyway, just to kind of flag that. So, you know, describe a time when you had to deal with a difficult coworker. Again, I'm going to pick on someone.
Question, Jeremy. So can you give an example of like what would be taking responsibility for your place in the conflict versus blaming yourself for the conflict? I don't quite understand the difference there.
Yeah, okay, great point. So let's imagine a very extreme example. I'm going to go back to that worst case scenario. You get pulled out, dragged out in front of your whole team. You got 20 people. The boss starts just, you know, telling everyone, hey, Jeremy just completely failed at hitting his KPIs for the quarter. He's an embarrassment, this and that. So there are a number of decisions that you actually are empowered to make, even though it seems like you aren't, right? In the moment, you feel trapped. And it's okay to even report that you felt trapped in the moment. But blaming yourself would be to say, yeah, you know, I mean, I had it coming, you know, I didn't hit my KPIs, and blah, blah, blah. Like, that would be accepting the, like, abuse that you just took. Whereas taking a sort of strategic view and saying, you know, what could I have done differently would sound like, you know, thinking back, I think the moment that he asked me to step in front of everyone, perhaps I could have told him, hey, can we have this conversation in private? Perhaps I could have said that during the dressing down, or maybe I could have circled around to him after this was all finished and asked him like, hey, that was really disrespectful and rude. I didn't appreciate that. I think we need to have a conversation about this. So just sort of an example, like there's always, with some personalities and especially with agreeable people, you run the risk of the person kind of conveying an acceptance of the abuse rather than conveying a strategic level thought of like, okay, here's how I could have played that out more optimally. That's sort of different from, oh, I deserved it, I had it coming. I hope that makes sense.
Yes.
Kind of.
I mean, it's just going to take some pondering, I think, on my own to figure out what that's like when I'm writing my own responses to these kind of questions.
Gotcha. Okay. Hopefully it'll crystallize a little bit here. It's not a problem that comes up that often. Like, it's not common to hear somebody say, like, yeah, my boss chewed me out and I deserved it. But I'm just trying to push in the direction of like, what are the constructive moves, right, that you could make to make the scenario better? If you're thinking along those lines, then I think you're probably fine one way or another. But yeah, so time when you had to deal with a difficult coworker, and I'll pick on Navjot.
Hi. So I would talk about my current boss. So I'm working in the field of logistics, and the problem is I needed this job for my work permit and permanent residency. And so my boss has a problem because he thinks I'm overqualified for this job. And I have a research mindset, so I don't like to be micromanaged. And he couldn't digest the fact that I was not asking for much of the help from him, completely entering in a new industry. I was handling the whole logistic company, which was handed over to me on my own. So he was kind of complaining about me, about the stuff that, oh, I call you at this time, you didn't reply me, you should have checked your Slack. So he was giving me written, you know, warnings regarding those things. So for me, I was like pissed off, like I'm doing my job, I'm producing quality work, what else I could do? So I talked with that guy that I'm seeing that these complaints, you are really pissed off with me. Tell me what can I do to make this thing better, because I don't see anything, any complaint regarding the, let's say, productivity or quality of the work. So I kind of threw the ball in his court so that he can come up with the solution instead of venting up his frustration on me. And I kind of acknowledge that I know you have 5 to 7 years of experience. I cannot match up with that. So that thing helped him to, you know, calm down that she is not considering herself equivalent to me. So he kind of, since then, we are on a good, you know, terms.
Okay. Great. So one quick thought here. This is a micro thing. I actually do it in my emails too, and my messages internally to coworkers at Sharpest Minds. So there are some terms, some words that set off alarm bells when you use them. And one of them is pissed off, right? So if I hear during an interview, the interviewee, no matter how reasonably, saying, you know, my boss was pissed off about this and that, it kind of makes me, it would be like hearing them say, you know, oh yeah, and my boss, he's a bit of a fucko, you know, like you sort of like, you hear that, it's not as bad as fucko, but it sort of makes you think like, oh wow, like is this, might there be like a maturity issue here or something like that, which is not the case. I think you're very reasonably expressing the scenario, but I would recommend, you know, maybe steering in the direction of a little bit more neutral descriptive language and saying like upset, for example. That because that might get you to where you want to go anyway without the kind of connotation.
Right.
Yeah. Now the I think your solution was actually sounds quite good. Again, there's just a little bit of a wording approach there where you signaled like I basically put the ball in his court so he would have to figure out and solve the problem. I suspect what may have happened is you actually did more of the problem solving than it might seem. Like, in a way, you turned to him and what you really said was, look, isn't what matters ultimately my productivity? Like, isn't that the main thing that we care about here? Isn't the other stuff really just vanity metrics? Like, stuff that we don't really care about, but like, you know, how rapidly did I respond to your message in like 5 minutes or did I respond to it in 30? Like, both are pretty reasonable, you know, time horizons. So maybe, you know, referring to it in those terms and saying like, I had a conversation with him about what it is that matters. Is it my productive output? Is it style? And are there standards maybe that we could set so that everything is more predictable and I know what acceptable response time is and what it isn't? Would that make sense?
Yeah, right.
Okay, great. Now, again, for what it's worth, I mean, I think that answer was really good in substance. It's just about like almost relating it like as objectively as you can, you know, just to make sure that you're not, you know, reading in words with negative connotations, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Awesome. You guys are doing really great. I mean, you're on the spot in front of so many people for the very first time. These answers have all been really solid. Okay, so I'm going to pick on Sifu next. So describe a time when you had to deal with a difficult coworker. Again, no pressure. Oh, actually, Sifu, are you able to talk or?
No, I'm here. Sorry. I was just trying to find my mute button. Okay. I'm kind of not completely prepared, so I'll try to sound like I know what I'm talking about here. I'm sorry.
No worries. Actually, as a quick kind of mini step here while you're thinking about your answer or playing around with possibilities.
Okay.
This is a great moment to flag that like you have way more permission to ask for time than you might imagine or certainly than I ever imagined when I started down this path. It is totally fine for you to step back and go, oh, you know, that's a really good question. Let me think about that for a second. And you can wait for like 30 seconds on that. You really can't. And for what it's worth, you're totally entitled to do so here.
Awesome. Great. Okay, so I can think of an example when I've dealt with what someone might call a difficult coworker. The situation was that we were tasked with coming up with a new project that would be able to optimize some costing in the hiring process. And the biggest challenge was that we had a coworker that we were working with that was far more senior than most of us. And while this particular person had a lot to offer, we met a lot of resistance because it was hard for them to see value in what we were bringing due to the experience dynamic. This made it difficult working with the person, but I found what made it easier to work with them was to step back, self-evaluate, and figure out what it was of value that I actually could bring to the table, and also think about what it was that their experience could provide to the table. Sometimes the very things that we see as the cause of conflict may be actually things that could help us in the long run in solving our problem. We came back and spoke with each other. We figured out a way to divide the work that would play to each of our strengths. And we found that we were able to collectively come up with a solution that was effective with minimal conflict along the way.
So I really like that answer, especially because you were so on the spot here. That was wonderful. I guess a couple of thoughts. So first off, the content of it was great. I think a little bit even more more detail would have been maybe helpful as well. If you have things to talk about, like the nature of the problem, I don't know what context this was in, but that could be good. And and the other thing. Jeremie, I'll get to your question in a second. It's a great question. The other thing I want to mention too is you did something at the beginning that I think might have slipped past us that was really great. You said I could.
Okay, I think it slipped past me too because I don't know what I did.
Oh no, that's great. Then let me highlight it for you. It's worth recognizing. So it was when you said I've encountered a situation that I think I could describe as a conflict with a person in a workplace or whatever. And this is a big giant out. If you're ever really stuck, if you find yourself thinking like, oh man, I really can't think of an example that satisfies this criterion, take a step back and ask yourself, what's the purpose of this interview? Right? The purpose of this interview is to establish that I'm a thoughtful person, that I'm measured, that I can be trusted not to blow my top at some, at any given conflict. And so any answer that you give that scratches that itch is going to move the needle for you. So one classic example is, I'll ask about a workplace question, and then somebody will respond with like, well, not really in the workplace, but when I was doing my master's, blah, 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 blah. And they'll talk about a research colleague or something like that, or even a group project in an undergrad or something like that. It's about like just figuring out what really do you want to learn with this question? And like, I'll give you an answer. It might not be exactly on target, but we all kind of get what this process is about. So let me share with you, my best attempt to scratch that itch. And whether or not your actual answer was, centered on an actual workplace thing or not, the fact that you were implicitly giving yourself a little bit of permission there, I think was a great move for what it's worth.
Okay.
So in your particular case, what was the context? Can you give a little bit more detail?
So the context was we were being, we're kind of being bought out by a different company, and some of the onboarding activities, they wanted us. Sorry, I'm not like I wouldn't be like this in an interview. I would have prepared like my story times and stuff like that. No. It's good. It's actually good for me. Good exercise. So we had to come up with processes that would streamline the onboarding procedure. They felt that the cost of the onboarding was far too high, but we needed to be able to still maintain the quality of the educational material that was being provided as new staff were being onboarded. So that was a challenge, finding that balancing act. The particular person that I was working with had been there 15 years. And the remainder of the people in the team were anywhere from 3 years and under. And so this particular person felt they knew more about what needed to happen But what we were bringing to the table is that we had kind of fresh eyes and we understood the challenges of the onboarding process more intimately than this person did. So there was that sense of value that we were bringing that she was unable to see. But her experience actually made her have a broader overview of this problem in general.
Ooh, okay. So your initial answer was great. The answer like this is fantastic because now you're telling a story. I feel bought into the story. Like I want to know what happens. So the more concreteness you can provide, it just got better and better. And it was an interesting situation too, you know, like an M&A situation and like okay. Everybody, you know. So anyway, long story short, I think this is a great illustration of how more on the ground detail actually kind of helps quite often. So great answer. I think you really do have the DNA of an excellent sort of line of response there.
So Jeremie, I think a question popped up in the chat, but I think it's similar to what I wanted to ask. I start to have this feeling. So that is kind of what I wanted to ask. Sometimes I feel like I'm long-winded, and I know that comes with like getting more practiced and rehearsed with what you're going to say. But when someone asks a question like this, should you be speaking for 3 minutes, 5 minutes? Certainly not a half hour. But what is that number that you should be shooting for?
Yeah, so I think generally speaking, 3 minutes is actually a decent, it's like decent ballpark. But more than that, you absolutely have permission to ask to be interrupted. So default to telling your story, tell a nice full-bodied story. By the way, the version you gave there with like all the detail, if you will, did not feel long-winded at all. And I think majority of people feel like they're being long-winded when they aren't. So that's a much more common mode. But if you're really worried about it, if you find yourself in an interview, like, am I blabbing right now? It's totally cool to say, you know, by the way, I'm happy to just kind of cut to the chase, but there's a little bit of detail I could fill in here. Do you want to hear it? And that's going to as well allow you to kind of get a little bit more relaxed because you don't feel like there's a ticking clock on every little detail and utterance. So for what it's worth.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. And I think that's actually, this idea of a collaboration between you and your interviewers is something that's sort of come up in different ways here, in a number of different ways. The first is like, I'm allowed to ask for a little bit of time to think, right? I'm allowed to step back and say, hey, the last thing you want to do is miss out on a really promising candidate just because you insisted on an answer within like 2 seconds, right? So you start by stepping back saying, hey, you know, that's a great question. Let me think about it. They're gonna grant you that because it's a collaboration, not a competition. And then second, when you step back and say, hey, you know, I'm gonna answer the flavor of the question. I'm not necessarily gonna give you the exact scenario you're asking for because I might not have lived that exact scenario. But let me give you something that sort of scratches a similar itch. And then likewise, as you're answering the question, you know, you have permission to say, hey, it's almost like they're a buddy of yours. Do you really want to hear this? I'm happy to go into the detail. I think it's important, but if you're not interested in that, that's totally cool. That makes you also seem a little bit more empathetic. It makes you seem like a better conversationalist. All these things really matter in that context. So give yourself permission to ask, you know, treat those interviewers not like a panel of independent judges, like people who can't be responded to or prodded. They're interactive. They're really there to talk with you rather than just interrogate. That's sort of it's a nice mindset shift also because it reflects reality and it'll also make you kind of lower that, or at least it does for me, lower that anxiety level, the baseline anxiety level, which usually helps ideas come to mind. Okay, we don't have time to look to do the same thing with the other two questions. I do want to just highlight them really quickly here. So tell me about a time you had to work under pressure. That was the other one. It was just tell me about a time you had to work under pressure. That's great. All these questions have a lot of the same sort of ingredients and flavor, right? Tell me about a time you had to work under pressure speaks to like, you know, your personality. How do you respond to pressure? In what ways do you respond imperfectly to pressure? In what ways are you good at dealing with pressure? That sounds an awful lot like strengths and weaknesses. What strategies have you come up with to mitigate your weaknesses when it comes to how you behave under pressure? What I really recommend doing is looking up behavioral interview questions. Literally type that into Google. You're gonna find there are surprisingly few. There are actually not that many. If you make a list of three or four different scenarios that you've been in, and here I would actually recommend starting with these three. Workplace conflict or dealing with a difficult coworker is one. A specific time where you had to deliver under pressure is another, and then general strengths and weaknesses. If you have three or four stories ready, that's usually all you'll need. You'll find that you can usually contort stories to answer different questions as well. Actually, as I just did when it came to strengths and weaknesses and time that you had to work under pressure, right? Like you can imagine following a similar thought process. So I think you'll find it's really helpful if you read like these lists of like 10 or 15 behavioral interview questions. There really aren't that many more than that. And make your set of three or four scenarios. You'll own those scenarios. You get really confident with them, telling those stories. Each of you has given really good answers, recited really good scenarios in your responses during this office hour. So that would be, for each of you, that would be definitely one to use in your set of three or four. And just round them out, you know, ask yourself if there are any interesting details you can add here or there. And then you can even time yourself issuing those answers. And almost regardless what the question is, you'll probably be able to like shoehorn it into a specific scenario into that answer. So anyway, I might leave that there. So my last point is just that, yeah, there is a lot of overlap, and that's almost the purpose of all this. The overlap, right, comes from here, right? Every question, fundamentally, you're trying to show introspection, show you can act on it, and show empathy. And that's where talking about your personality traits, talking about how you've mitigated the more negative consequences of those personality traits, that ticks two boxes right away. And then it's just about making sure that you don't call anybody names along the way to show empathy. So does anybody have any questions about any of the stuff we talked about today? Okay. Cool. If you do, follow up with me on Slack. I'm going to post the personality inventory link, so you can all check that out. You'll be able to do a free one. There are a whole bunch of free websites that are still totally legit. So I'll post that on Slack, and if you have questions, let me know. And in the meantime, yeah, great work to everybody who answered questions. They were really good, and I'm sure you'll do very well. So with that, I'll leave you guys to it, and we'll talk later.